fish, now there's no swordfish. Had a swordfish, now there's no swordfish. So we have a few sort of ways of defining our moments in time. Deep down is always about revolving around the idea of people, working with people. We do a lot of work from planning, urban design level. So the first is about people in the built environment, and then we move on to sort of smaller scale, working with the greenery, and then working with the community, getting closer to the people. The last one that we will talk about is about people and aspirations. What Tony sort of mentioned earlier about getting close to the people, working with the young ones so that from the level of the low level where you sort of introduce them by education, by practice, by experience, they will just pick it up and take it on from there. So that's the sort of idea of sustainability. Sustainability through learning, through certain habit, and then potentially we think then this can become a cultural practice, and voila, that's really what we strive and aim to do. So there's in this sort of movement here, looking at urban design and planning, there's sort of three areas that I'll talk about, and essentially it's about how people experience the urban environment from pedestrian level, street level. And you like to create a certain character. When we do urban design, you like to create a character because you're not the architect. And how this idea of barrier-free to get buildings to be connected to each other becomes really important, and how we kind of then use guidelines to define it and control the sort of desired environment to be built. Another sort of area that we look at would be at a greater level. Well, the world is global now. How a site, a place, is placed within the environment, in a global environment, the idea of placemaking, the idea of mobility of people, activities around it, and we look at programming a city in that way. And then water comes in. We cannot deny water. We're living in a sort of a tropical country. Dealing with water also involves a sustainable approach to infrastructure, how we deal with greenery and water. And ultimately, we like to create a sense of living that's authentic, not one that is kind of manufactured, kind of a Disney way. And we have to use urban design principles to basically grow the place out of its own genius loci, which you see. So I experienced this earlier. The project is in Putri Harbour. And the site that we looked at, we did the urban design, we did master planning and urban design study for this, and we use an exemplar site here. Now, next, this doesn't work. So to achieve this, we have to introduce a veranda typology. Topology where there is no setback, buildings really come to the edge of the street, and people then would have this seamless movement between the public domain and the street, and then this would relegate the cars to areas that are not fronting the street. You can see here that we managed to get this approved up at the state planning level by the Menteri Besar. So it's quite a feat done by a private developer and not by a government agency in this case. Next slide. So you see from here how the veranda connects the building together. The veranda does, in fact, define an urban space within it. Cars can come in through this motor court. And by doing so, the cars don't quite destroy the street character, and people can move freely undercover and so on. So next slide, we have the nano project that essentially it's about connecting people. Well, the site is basically one railway stop from KLIA. And between KLIA and KL Central, through MSC, through the railway line, we see this as really taking people directly from overseas in a sort of global manner onto the site. So the idea of connecting people becomes even more important, anchored by a university campus. So then we built the whole concept of urban commercial along this linkage that would link people to, from the station to the university and the surrounding residential area. These are the programs that we kind of planned for the area to give you a sort of a richness in activities and so on. So each area has a different sort of activities for different age groups and so on. So the linkage through the commercial area works now. In a way, defines how we arrange commercial buildings. We push the commercial buildings to one side, make them more intense, and then and that would leave about a third of the area to private landscape, private park, and then you can place iconic buildings there for more kind of a public usage. That works, right? And the buildings would have to be linked together. In the tropical manner, we link the buildings together. The great thing is, as you come out of station, which is hardly done here, you normally get on a higher level, so we can use pedestrian bridges and so on. So the idea of using pedestrian bridges actually allows you to connect people multi-level, lift them up higher. By doing so, you can actually start rearranging the shops in a different way, whereby you don't just place all the nice restaurants on the ground floor, then you can actually lift them up. So the thinking then is based on the idea of the speed of travel. Robert Venturi talked about speed of travel and the things you see. So as you go faster, you see certain things. You want to see the name of a bookstore, borders, or whatever. But at the lower level, as you move slower, then you would like to see what's served on the table, the cake, the faces, and so on. And in this way, you actually stratify the movement. You spread it across many floors, and then the developers will like it because then they can sell a lot more ground floors. And they basically link the station through the plaza across here to the student center of the university, leaving this parkland free for to be then integrated with retention ponds and so on as part of the requirement. This is another iteration of this idea that it can be kind of less rigid, more sort of organic and form, linking buildings together based on the same principles, linking the two nodes, the two stations together. If you want to draw a nice perspective, this is what it would look like. The principles are the same here. This moves on to a more intimate residential area. We were asked to look at the overall planning of the light Penang. We went on to focus more on the urban design guidelines for this area, working with four or five different architects, defining what the whole collection of buildings should come together and how they work together. So what is important is looking at infrastructure in a sustainable way, in a way that you don't necessarily spend money when you don't have to. We found that there's a certain line where it's just too costly to reclaim the land. And we thought, okay, this is a blue dotted line here. Why don't we just look at other sort of typology that you can turn it around and enhance it. So then we have a series of buildings on water like piers that is entirely new for Penang or this part of the world. And the urban design guidelines specifically mention how the buildings would be stacked up because it's done by one developer, it's quite easy. And by doing so, you enjoy views, clear views, views through vistas and corridors, letting the most exclusive, the most expensive properties at the waterfront, having direct access to water, and the taller ones at the back, giving some kind of form of buffer as well. Google is amazing because it does as-built drawings for us. You know, you don't have to go back and do as-built drawing, and then it looks the result is very much 80% of what we intended. The project that we designed here is the Five Finger Wharf residential building floating on water here. let's say, overall perspective. The picture you see here is an overhead picture. There is a covered walkway that which doubles as, it's got many functions. It's also the drop-off, it's also the access, the street bazaar for the residents in that area, going on to the marina. And we had to let the fire engine come through. So this is a diagram of the five fingers, the multi-layers of community domains linking the people together. There's basically three layers, and going down the smaller pocket spaces where the aunties can actually talk to each other in a sort of a chance way, coming out of the yard, the kitchen, and so on. And the emphasis then is put on linkages, how this can be linked together. The central piece here is the walkway through the middle, appropriately so through the middle finger, going to the marina. And then the view of this, of the apartments floating on water, they're on marine piles, and the marina you can see on the right-hand side here. There are various spaces, there are smaller poolside spaces, the rooftop spaces that we can sort of explore out of this collection of smaller buildings, an assemblage of smaller buildings. For the record, this is probably the longest distance Wi-Fi in the world. We took the picture of us from the swimming pool. If you're a good swimmer, you would be able to swim here from, you'll be able to swim from here to Pry. New meaning to infinity pool, you can swim here. You can swim from Penang to Singapore, Batam, or maybe JB. These are the small spaces. They become incidental spaces, walking from the car park, going up different floors, elevated walk linkages, corridors, where the people from in the yards of the apartments can actually have a conversation, strike a conversation. Smaller incidental spaces where you can actually explore into intimate gardens, the rooftop. There is a need to link the various buildings together because they kind of are varied across different stories and so on. There's a need for a covered walkway, so we do a covered walkway. There's a need to screen it off, so you do a screen. So what better way to do than using greenery to screen it off? And we got naughty, you know, lots of rainwater gutters. You got to go to collect rainwater, and where do you put it? Okay, just turn the roof into an echo duct, and we'll just collect rainwater and come down. And interestingly, then the water would just leak through the plants, and it would just irrigate the plants. So this is the first attempt at collecting rainwater at the rooftop. Let it leak down. Contractors kind of always get quite shocked when we tell them to make holes in the gutters and rainwater down pipes, and they come and collect through the system. It's filtered through the planting, the flat roof, gets collected. We were hoping to use it as a makeup tank for the swimming pool, but due to various reasons, it is decided not to. But at least I think the fish will be happy because the water is clean. And once in a while, you get this chance to do this nice sketch to show how the ideas turn into reality. As usual, this is we call it the fishbone entrance. It's just a naughty way to solve not a complex problem, because the problem involves connecting people from different levels, there's 3-4 levels. Being good architects, you got to look at the sunlight, wind, rain, and so on. And so we would then like people to be like Pinocchio, take them through this the guts of the whale fishbone here. And on the, you can see there's the entrance to the apartments, the reception area on the left. On the right-hand side, the firemen need to go through, drive the fire engine through here and onto the marina. There'll be shops in the future coming towards the right-hand side, and people then can enjoy the waterfront view. The bridges connecting in between. So this is level 2. Level 1 goes down to the marina. The bridge at level 2, bridge at level 3, connecting the green decks together. And we put the structure over it. everything is warp. Probably reflects the sense of the architect's state of mind. There's a deck over for you to do a titanic moments for yoga. That's the bridge, and then cool enough, the fire engine comes through. That's a real view. Turn around, fly through. It shows you sort of changes of light. And even the lion is happy. Does it move? Okay. In different light, evening, it's quite interesting, the sort of lures that we've created out of simple polycarbonate panels. They give you that sort of lantern translucent effect. The view of the bridge, the two bridges. We got naughty in, but we got through. So the bridge is actually quite interesting. It's never straight. And it's a place for occasions, for events as well. Now, then we move into a sort of a slightly smaller scale. Actually, it does get big when we got brave. We start with small, little attempts in doing greenery. So this is really the first one where we sort of introduce green courtyards into buildings that we do, mainly for environmental reasons, for reasons where we kind of allow the circulation spaces, the buildings to be cooled down by the environment, by the trees. I'll just pass to Stephen to take you through the rest.
This chapter, we would like to share with you about the greenery in our design approach. My first encounter of the greenery principle in Garis Architect, actually during my school time, many years back. This is the project that, when I do the research, this has come to the research. Okay. Where we notice that the rainwater have been collected in a very passive rainwater collection manner that integrated with the drainage and also the irrigation system. So this is the idea that actually is made me interested in looking at the greenery at the very beginning. So in more and more, then we're actually looking at greenery principle to be further explored in with more human-centric approach in our future design. So the first project that we'd like to show is basically a spiral space house. Actually, the project is kind of quite a small project at sited at PJ Old Town. The client have the intention of trying to relate to outside world and enjoy the natural surrounding. So in the PJ Old Town is where you have a very mature line neighborhood, and then with a green roof approach, architecture will be the one that get closer to relate to the natural surroundings. So this is the image that brought up by the client, that they actually very interested in looking at the multicultural suburban landscape, that if you looking at the images, you actually have a multicultural and religious building surrounding it. And the Bukit Gasing actually is just right behind it. So it's actually set a quite interesting suburban landscape in the totality. So at the very fundamental idea, the project is actually started when we start to looking at the spaces and being unwrapping out the space, and then function and human consciousness is continuously outward tending, and then culminating the green folded roof open out to the sky. That's the most fundamental idea that we start to look at it. The roof actually is the one that get the client to have the closer view to the certain natural surroundings, and the roof itself actually is a self-irrigated and collected whilst the soil and low-tech water cells. So during the construction time, the project is in the way that the clay roof tiles and the bricks has been collected and tried to be reused. The most interesting idea for this project is if you're looking at the water cells being formed by the reused bricks, this is where that we try to actually kind of retain the water at a certain hours that get the water to be contained at this before it's actually run off.
The cells, what the cells do, they actually work like fish scales. They actually retain and collect water, they dam it up to a certain degree. Well, one thing that we didn't do is sort of do it scientifically in an empirical way, but it does work that it holds water. The owner told me that it was a period of about 2 months that nobody came to water the plants, the roof, and it survived. So it's proven in that way, by gut feeling.
So instead of the interior spaces, the client actually enjoy more at the rooftop landscape, and then enjoying where is the nature surrounding, and at the same time, they would like to hear the echoes of the multicultural, where you have the religious building, the sound from the temple, the sound from the mosque, and also the churches around it. So this is kind of quite unique experimental project in the office where we start looking at the green roof approach. The next project actually is Symphony Hill Clubhouse, when the site is quite unique in such a way that we're looking at the green roof in a different manner, where we try to look at not only just standing at the green roof looking out, but this is more like the view source for the surrounding. The site actually lies at the in the valleys of formation, and then where the both sides actually is the housing enclaves. So it does essentially, the built environment, it become the itself become the source of the attractive views for the surrounding. So the clubhouse designed in such a manner that it's not a big chunk building, so it's been fragmented in small little pavilion, five little pavilion, and then scattered around the waterways and water park. So this is kind of the act that we actually looking at the green roof become the source of the view. At the same time, the space in between become where the activities and also the source of the view for the pavilion itself. So the modular structure have been introduced for this project, where the V section for the beam and also the portal light of the V section of the post and beam and also the column, is it become a very interesting feature that we actually drain the water from the folded roof and then down towards the V channel beam and then down towards the waterways. It's kind of using the structure become part of the services. And this is the model done by the contractor. When they come to us, when they saw the drawing, they actually don't know how actually the folder loop actually can work. So when they show this model, we tell them that's a right from the profile. And then the water actually with the design gradient and then come down to the pipe sleeve and then go down to the V channel and then drain down to the waterways. So the placement of the pavilion is kind of fragmented, and then it's been twisted and meandered. The walkway have been twisted and meandered that try to capture the different angles of the view. At the same time, it's actually create a very interesting view from different angles. So the entire clubhouse actually kind of linked by this serpentine walkway, where it's offering the shifting vista from different angle. At the same time, we are trying to play with the different levels of the benches that try to create the different height of the sitting for adult and also for the kids. At the same time, it's also try to test the behavior of the people that who actually lie down at the benches and or they actually sit at the bench. So this serpentine walkway actually acting as a connector, and then it's indirectly actually create the inside out spaces in between the pavilion and the walkway. And at the same time, this vertical landscape racks actually is being formed to actually create that kind of sun shading and also cooling effect to the pavilions. When we have tested out few green roof approach architecture project, that we found that it's actually get a brave and braver when we're looking at the different scale of the project. This project is the art that we did 3 years ago. So we started the project from the master plan level, 1,800 over acres, then looking at how the community planning in the overall context. And then it started to subdivide that into more on residential enclave and also the commercial hub in the future. So this, the art actually is kind of the connector in between the residential enclave and also the commercial hub. So this project is kind of very interesting that the design brief come to us only talking about sales gallery and also the clubhouse. So kind of interesting when we're talking to the authority saying that instead of the compliance of the football field in the overall master plan, why not we include that in our commercial development? At the same time, it become part of communal space instead of you place it the football field elsewhere. So at the same time, because of 1,800 over acres of the development, we've spoken to developers saying that you have to get the people in, bring the people into the development instead of you start to talking about selling the product. So this is where we start to talk about that you need to bring in the crowd, you need to create the communal space, and then you have to create some events to attract people in very far in from the main road. So the design brief is kind of evolved when we start looking at the park and the future commercial connection. IGN being the builder, they are very, very experienced in building the highway. So you will notice that the diagram show the park, in between park and commercial actually separated by this highway. So we kind of advise the client, convince the client to say that why not actually you more emphasize on the pedestrian, try to fly, to create a flyover, and then more emphasize on the pedestrian linkage in between the residential enclave and the commercial hub. So at the same time, then the act of placing the football field become the communal space, and then after that, the act on putting the habitable component at this area, but yet at the same time, try to create the views for this development. So always we try to create more permeability for the development and then try to elevate the entire green roof for the entire structure. The sketches actually started when we start to look at not only the art structure, but at the same time try to bring back the essence of the historical of the township development where previously Bandar Rimbaya actually's name is a canal city. So the water level actually is kind of high table at that area. So we kind of try to bring back that kind of essence. So this is the image that we taken 2 weeks ago. The trees and the plants actually grow very well and then it's been matured throughout, not only at the ground floor, also at the elevator deck. And then this man-made intervention actually is demarcation of the act of placemaking to establish the identity for community for this entire township. So the whole idea of try to bring the better ambience and also quality sports event to this area where client not only looking at the football field, at the same time, they also try to make this field become the rugby where IGM is very emphasized on. So this project is kind of have a few selling point that is not only have 10,000 square meter rooftop garden, at the same time, it's also have 20,000 self-sustained lake rainwater retention. And at the same time, you have the multi-sport field, cover community bazaar as a connecting pedestrian street and community events venue. So the entire canal parkland surrounds pocket green space. And they also create the herbs and garden, flower garden. This will be the future community hub for the entire public amenities and also community space for multi-purpose hall. So the recent shell sales gallery will eventually turn into the multi-purpose hall. So the conveys a very important sense of comfort to the community is important, where the recreation canal is simultaneously become the rainwater collection vessel. So the content of this try to reuse for the irrigation purposes for the entire landscape. So the notes from the land from the client saying that there is zero surplus water have been used for irrigation purpose. At the very beginning, the placemaking strategies have been established when we start to mark out what kind of activities to be happen on not only at the rooftop and also at the bazaar level. So the idea of trying to be vehicle-free pedestrian promenade connector between the residential enclave and commercial hub. The the project kind of challenged not only at the design stage, also at the stage of when we start the construction, and also to convince the authority. Even during the construction stage, the client intend to pull the handbrake, say that why should we build this big structure, because they don't see the value of it from the beginning. So, and then after that, we start to working with the landscape architect, come up with this HDPE membrane to be the underlay of the water features. The water features is only 450 to 600 depth. Another feature that in this development is, if you're looking at the downpipe at this area, is kind of all the downpipes being bent, it's not straight down. And then even the contractor asks us, why do you bend the downpipe? And then why you try to further elaborate on the downpipe? So the intention of make this as a green column, all this downpipe being bent, and at the horizontal is there's a 4 mm hole of the water, try to actually collect the water and then drip down to shower the creepers at the green column.
After what we've done in Penang, we got a bit more adventurous and still work.
So this entire giant structure, actually from the height of 6 meter to 9 meter, actually try to create the kind of the gravity flow to channel all the water to the site and then drain down through the green column. So after the water being collected at the edge and then drained down through the green column, shower the creepers at the green column, and then come down to the canal. The canal actually been designed in three different levels, that we have three different tiers. We work with the RO specialist from Singapore, talking about how to get the water circulate and then pump it out at the same time to irrigate the landscape. So the plants getting more and more matured, and then this is where the urban farming at this area try to create a kind of very inclusive community space at this township. So even the car park, it be designed that this is where the swell that where the all the water will drain down to the canal. So the stormwater drainage and also the collection system, we try to turn it into very positive and compelling and interactive design in placemaking. So all these things try to be incorporated into architecture and landscape at conception level. So highway-like structure has been softened by curtain creepers. And then also this structure became more dramatic when the presence of the breeze and even the wind. So the view through the curtain creepers is kind of quite tranquility, and then produce a great sense of the belonging to the peoples here. So even if you look at the floor finish, it's been designed that it's considering the heavy usage of the by the communities, and then this removable bricks is have been ready laid with the cable and services that it function for. It's actually ready for the future events and also the future shops. So functionally, this structure actually provide the shelter and also serve as a collective public space and public domain for various community activities. So this is one of the interesting placemaking project that we always looking at the power of 10 and then looking at more the power of 10. So looking at this activity can be happen at this area. And actually it promotes a social interaction. So at the very beginning, we start to looking at the 10,000 square meters of the spaces, that what kind of activities and what kind of arrangement of the public activity at this area. We start to look at the outdoor banquet, where this is what is the real image, and then start to look at the cafeteria and retail and food trucks party. And even we also looking at what kind of sports activities, and even the basketball tournament can happen here because of the ceiling height of the 9 meter ceiling height. And also sometimes kids fun fair and games and family gathering. This is one of the projects that we are not only at the level of talking to the contractor to get the construction, the structure done. Also, we work very closely with the marketing person, because the marketing person is the very first person came to us to say that why do I need such a hill structure? So at the end of the day, now the marketing group actually more appreciate this structure because they doesn't need to build the extra tents for the launches purpose and also their events. So all the bazaar have been ready for the activities and comprehensive public space agenda. Even at night, this structure can be visually pleasing and it promotes the sense of the comfort for the entire space. So we even hear from the marketing person to say that some so-called young couples would like to get a banquet over here for their marriage. This is where the community garden happened at this area, and where they try to make the parkland and public space more inclusive for community. So for the entire development, we are trying to be more community-oriented and then try to be more people-centric and on to the approach of the placemaking. So besides the emphasis on the community, this development actually supports the new ecosystem and support the biodiversity. Sometimes you would like to hear from the user and even from the social media that you start to hear from the client say that there's the wildlife and also all the insects flying to the office, and then it creates a very pleasant office spaces. We always believe that the space and the community space is not only with care, with a love, and also with for the community, and not only for their events, also for the daily recreation outing and also neighborhood events. The next topic that we would like to talk about, the peoples and community. This try to outline the example in our practice over the time, reflective in the quite different scale of the project. So the neighborhood community is always important at the housing project and also at the commercial project or even in the city. So throughout the year, we actually spend most of our time on the drawing board, trying to create a different quality of the interactive space from the small scale of 1-to-1 to 1,000, and then even in a diverse context. So we've always emphasized on the Kevin Lynch image of the city and also the Christopher Alexander pattern language, that kind of experience at the street. So the project that we started with, the housing project, were very emphasized on the community, not only at the range of the cluster housing and also some of the community pocket space. So very early project that we have at Lagenda at Bukit Jelutong, this is one of the earliest cluster home project that we emphasize on the expression of the spirit of the space and genius loci. So turn to the other way, when we're looking at the Symphony Hills, the cluster home, it become more linear, and then it's actually created in a different manner of the community space, that you have the street at the front, and then but you're at the parkland at the behind, and then actually it's focusing into the park waterways and parkland. The other project, when we're looking at the commercial, how to create the kind of marketplace, and then which emphasize on the placemaking with the old village charm character and functioning as a marketplace and urban nooks. This project at Cyber Jaya, where we're looking at Tamarind Square in quite a different manner of approach of the retail component, where 70 shop front line out at the front, and you have another garden shop office with the multi-podium car park hidden behind. So the project become the very interesting, try to innovate and reinvent the sense of space, not only at the street level, at the upper street level, and even at the center courtyard, where it become the main marketplace of the entire place. So in terms of the urban design, it create actually different character, three different character from the lower street to the upper street and to the center courtyard, which with a very creative landscape design. So the multiple function space with more adaptability and also engage with the community with public amenities, it happened at this development where the clients start to bring in those kind of community activities and even book at 24 hours book access at this area. The last project for these topics, we would like to talk about the public space in the city. 10 days before the World Urban Forum, KL, we've been invited to collaborate with UN Habitat looking at pop-up installation to address the awareness and to create the awareness for the public, importance of public space and quality of the public space. The installation work try to intend to bring the community together. At the same time, try to create the interactive arts formed by this combination of 36 vertical modular of symphony horns in various height. So the as the people speak through all these we so-called symphony horns, the voice are amplified through the sky. And then at the same time, children can also explore the playful qualities of the sound by talking at one end to produce sound for the listener to at the other end. So with 2 days of design work, 2 days of getting the design approved by UN Habitat and DBKL, and then this pro bono project that we actually install everything by ourselves with our own team here. And then this urban symphony fundamentally trying to demonstrate the versatile of the public space and also what kind of the sitting place is important at this area.
Well, this movement here about people and aspirations is really about our bid to get closer, interact with people more, and really go down to the level where people kind of operate, so that we can actually gain more from it, and when we do projects in future, that is this sense of understanding and connectivity with the people. So we're just being asked to do an interior of a sales gallery, so not to be contented with that, that's just an interior. We got a chance to recycle some old, reuse some old timber from an old factory, and then started looking at the meaning of this thing in an otherwise a shop lot. How can we then use this as a platform to build community, to engage with the children and let the community come around? And otherwise, just some shop lots and an open space, the 10% open space requirement. The first thing you do is, okay, let's look at rainwater, collect it, make it useful, put it in the aquaponic urban farm, and place the children's playground area next to it. This is using the recycled timber, using industrial statics in the gallery, moving out to the little aqueduct pergola structure, linking the the children's playground play structure. It's a diagram of how water is collected through the aqueduct, irrigating the aquaponic systems and the natural conventional farming plots. So you get to have fun doing little water wheels. These pictures are kind of a big, only 1 week old, so it's still under construction. Then just to feel young again, we were young once. We look at this playground structure, climbing structure for kids. In a way, kids are cute like hamsters, you know. You let them play in the cage, you watch them from afar, keep them safe. It's quite cool, isn't it? So this structure is like a hamster structure that kids play in, and you just keep them afar, and then you can get on with your life left. And that's a picture, 1 week old, of the structure where kids get to climb to go up to the slide, used it, and climb out the other way. They can get to explore sort of spaces in a different way instead of a very sort of a structured way. instead of just climbing a ladder at the back of the slide and then just sort of come up and down and get parents very anxious. So this is just a different way of looking at it, reinterpreting the idea of a playground structure. I think we're running out of time. These are just examples of different projects that we kind of got ourselves into, looking at defining spaces for its specific experience function, different interpretations of its context. Here, what you can do, what you looking views, capturing views here and there. I have to talk to you, any of you who are interested in this over a cup of coffee. This is really a project that we'd like to take to the local government and improve the connectivity via cycling, using cycling as a means to build up the community. This plan shows that most of the traffic connections in PJ are going east-west. There's a lack of north-south connection. So we've identified a series of corridors which are traffic-free. That's easy for you to cycle. You can even use your electric bikes because it's not on JPJ roads. They're not going to come and catch you. Back at home, at work, it's really the place where we test out ideas, we experiment with different ideas, and it's also where we kind of have the support. You go between being practical, law-abiding, and trying out different ideas, being crazy about what you do. So this is it, and this is not a wall of fame. We call it a wall of gratitude. It's basically a collection of Google snapshots of our projects, and we use it as a sort of critique, self-critique, and make comments about the projects over time. In a way, it's also a recognition of the people who have worked with us, our family members, colleagues, consultants, clients, authorities who have made all our projects possible. Thank you.